Welcome to the future, where the glass is half full and you'll need new glasses, where you'll be jumping from conclusions.
The past is annulled, and a new future is born.
Never before in history has so much meant so little to so many. AD on the radio.
So back in the day, I'll never forget, back in the day, I heard about something kind of sort of gross and terrifying and invasive happening to this guy in a band that I knew. And I didn't know him. I didn't know him personally. But like my band, when we came to England from America, or came to America from England, rather, we holed up in Long Island, lived in Bayville, New York for a while. Then I lived in Seacliff, New York for a while. If you know the area, you know exactly where I'm talking about. And it's close to this Ray recording studio where we basically lived for the better part of a year in Glen Cove, called Cove City Sound Studios. And this was right around the time where I guess the Long Island emo or hardcore scene was quite a thing. Like Long Island went from being a musical joke for the longest time. Like people in the city called Long Island Bridge and Tunnel. Bridge and Tunnel was an expression for people that were not city dwellers. If you weren't on the island of Manhattan and you went into the city, you would do so by taking either a bridge or a tunnel. And Bridge and Tunnel was sort of like quite an insult. Those folks are Bridge and Tunnel. They're de classe. And these Bridge and Tunnel criticisms were often aimed at people from Long Island and people from New Jersey. And well, Long Island was anything but cool for the longest time. So it was a real surprise, I think, to the entire world when all of a sudden the Long Island punk rock scene, the Long Island emo scene became a thing. And I remember hearing about this one band that was just really blowing up, and I thought their song was kind of nifty, and I thought they were definitely different from a lot of what was making the rounds in those days. And then I met somebody that worked with this band, and he was like, oh man, the craziest thing happened to him. I was like, what's that? He's like, well, he was kind of messing around on Skype or some sort of video chat thing, which I guess has been going since 2003. A lot of people, when these stories started to come out about this guy, were just like, no, Skype wasn't a thing back in the day. The person who's telling the story is lying. Skype, I guess, has been around since 2002 through 2003. But this guy was messing around with some girl on Skype, and she took screenshots of it, and now there's pictures of him in an intimate and compromised position, maybe making the rounds on the internet. And this guy that worked with him said, yeah, we had to kind of do some stuff to make that go away. It was a big, big pain. The guy's very sort of like private and personal, and that was a lousy thing to have to happen to him. I was like, well, dumbass shouldn't have been getting naked on a webcam, but yeah, I guess it was his fault for being too trusting. In no way, shape, or form did I ever imagine that the person, and I don't know if this is the same person, but in no way, shape, or form did I ever imagine the person with the incriminating screenshots of this guy, and the singer of a band called Brand New, Jesse Lacey, was an underage girl. Did you catch this, Funkhouser? Did you ever listen to Brand New back in the day?
But I've been out of the loop for like a week, so I don't know all the details or names. But the guy from Brand New?
Yeah, the guy from Brand New. Like, I mean, here's the thing. As it turns out, as the folks over in SNL put it this past weekend just gone by, we found out over the last week or so that everybody we knew is a horrifying sex monster. And Jesse, the guy from Brand New, I guess falls kind of squarely into that category. There was some dude who used to, I think, be their guitar tech who said, hey, as long as we're talking about, you know, creepy sex predators, what about Jesse from Brand New? And this was just something he wrote on Facebook, I think, to his friends. You know, maybe it was a snarky swipe at Jesse from Brand New, but the thread grew and grew. And there was this one girl who said, yeah, that guy absolutely ruined my life when I was like 15 years old. He would force me to do all this stuff on Skype. And she even said, I've got screenshots on an old computer somewhere if I felt like dredging up the past. And she said that, you know, she basically, at the time, didn't realize what was going on, didn't realize the impropriety of what was happening, didn't realize basically this was a form of child abuse, didn't realize she was living through it because she was a 15-year-old girl, and this was like a guy in her favorite band, and he was getting her to do these things, and she kind of took it as like, I'm special, I'm different, this is a form of affection, when in fact it was child abuse. And she started talking about it, and it just blew up all over the internet, and people went, what the hell? And I guess it's one of those sort of Cosby-esque things where there's a certain amount of smoke, so people naturally assume there's fire. And this guy, the guy Jesse from Brand New, he apologized, but unless I'm missing something, it was one of the most inadequate apologies I've ever come across in my entire life. We'll get into it next.
Real radio.
104.1.
Where the left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio. On Twitter at ADSXE.
So like I was saying, after having lived in Long Island for a little while, where we were posted up making a record, you very quickly became aware of Long Island's reputation, musically speaking. Long Island was a home of big hair, of music that hadn't evolved since the 80s. Long Island's big musical export was Twisted Sister. They didn't score a lot of cool points, musically speaking, on Long Island. And then, weirdly enough, while I was living there, inexplicably, Long Island became the home of all things cool. There were all these sort of like, I guess, screamo, emo, punk rock bands from Long Island. Bands like Glassjaw, bands like Brand New. And there was like the Long Island sound. People in England, where I grew up, were talking about like, yeah, I'm really into the Long Island hardcore sound. That's my thing. I'm really into the Long Island sound. I'm like, if you only knew, the Long Island sound was considered to be something very different like 6 months ago. But there was an air. There was an air about these bands, for sure. They were different. They dressed a little different. They looked a little different. And people thought, wow, there's something about them. These Long Island bands, they're cool. They're really cool. And if you ever ran into them, I don't know if they were doing it purposely, but when you ran into people that were sort of in that Long Island scene, they definitely had a different thing to them where they seemed like they were cool as well, you know? You ever meet someone and you think, man, they're so cool. They're definitely part of a club I'm not. They're in and I'm just hanging around the periphery in their orbit. There's something they know that they've got that the rest of us don't, and we all want a piece of it. It's a weird thing. Cool. And I guess because of that weird sort of aura and mystique that these bands had around them, and people like Jesse, the lead singer of Brand New, had around him, you could easily understand how a 15-year-old girl who was a massive fan of the band could be coerced into essentially participating in child pornography and child abuse. Jesse, the lead singer of Brand New, 15 years ago, I guess, was messing around with underage girls on Skype who happened to be fans. And it came back to bite him in the ass a couple days ago. Allegations about him, including accusations of actions that occurred when victims were underage teens, surfaced on Facebook, as we were discussing a little while ago. And he apologized. He said, "The actions of my past have caused pain and harm to a number of people, and I want to say that I'm absolutely sorry. I do not stand in defense of myself, nor do I forgive myself. I was selfish, narcissistic, and insensitive in my past, and there are a number of people who have had to shoulder the burden of my failures. I apologize for the hurt I have caused, and I hope to be able to take the correct actions to earn forgiveness and trust." The accusations against Lacey first surfaced, like I said, on Facebook just a couple days ago, November 9th. A whole bunch of women have since stepped forward, including this one woman who in 2002, when she was 15 and Lacey was in his 20s, was asked by Lacey to send him naked photos. And also, they messed around on Skype. She said, "He solicited nudes from me starting when I was 15 and he was 24, manipulated the hell out of me, demanded specific poses, settings, clothing, demeaned me, made it clear that my sexuality was the only thing I had to offer. I should have known better by then. but he had screwed me up so much psychologically, all I wanted was his approval. It effed me up to the point that I still have nightmares and wake up in a sweat. I still break down and have panic attacks when people play Brand New in a bar. And so he apologized. He didn't specifically address this woman, though. He said, "I'm sorry for how I have hurt people, mistreated them, lied, and cheated." He said he had a dependent, addictive relationship with sex. He said, "I'm sorry for ignoring the way in which my position, status, and power as a member of a band affected the way people viewed me or their approach to their interactions with me. And I'm sorry how often I have not afforded women the respect, support, or honesty that they deserve, which is their right." And now he's apologized. Now he said, "Yeah, I was a horrible, disgusting pig that participated." Well, no, here's the thing. Here's the thing that bothers me. Here's the thing that bothers me. Because he does all this sort of like, I was narcissistic. I had this weird disconnected relationship with sex. My wife has really suffered through this. I've got problems. I've been unfaithful, blah, blah, blah. I have an addictive relationship with sex. But at no point did he say, "I'm a disgusting child pornographer and I need to be stopped." And that's the weird thing. I don't know if he's going to be allowed to skate on this in the court of public opinion or in terms of what's legal. I don't know if having received naked photos of a 15-year-old after you tell that 15-year-old to send specific naked photos to you, I don't know if that's still punishable 15 years later. I don't know if there's a statute of limitations on this, but there shouldn't be. Shouldn't be allowed to skate. Shouldn't be allowed to get away with saying, "I have an addictive relationship with sex and I've hurt people and I'm truly sorry." He said, "I was selfish and narcissistic." It's child porn. It goes so far beyond selfish. Goes so far beyond narcissistic and insensitive. Goes so far beyond your dependent, addictive relationship with sex. He says that lust, sex, and love and arousal were coping tools for me. And he returned to them repeatedly. It's a crazy way to make an apology for participating in child pornography about how your life is so hard.
For more stimulation and less irritation, 9 out of 10 doctors choose KPRC AM 950.
Houston's more stimulating talk radio.
Don't get the blues, get all the news. We mean all of you guys out there in Radio Land.
All aboard!
He's back. AD on the radio.
Give it up, yeah. Give it up, yeah. Bring this on, bring this on. Come on, come on.
All right, Funkhouser, who else is a disgusting sex monster? Anyone else we'd like to add to the list?
Oh, man. Well, I heard about Louis C.K.
George Bush has been accused of groping a 16-year-old during a photo op. Did you see this?
Junior or senior?
No, senior. There's been all these sort of things coming out about him being sort of grabby McFeels a lot. And Rosalind Corrigan, the daughter of a CIA employee based in Texas, told Time magazine that the 41st president grabbed her behind when he visited her father's office and took a photo with her family in November of 2003. Now, here's the thing. The account of it. Look, George H.W. Bush is infirm. He's in a wheelchair. There's people that say he can't like get his arm up necessary to, you know, sort of when he goes to put his arm around you in a photograph, he can't really get it up to where it would need to be. So it is natural that it would brush against your buttocks or your posterior. And then he would make a joke saying, I'm David Copperfield. That's my favorite magician, to sort of excuse the fact that he couldn't lift his arm up past a certain point. Well, the account of the situation sort of makes it sound in no way, shape, or form could it have been an accident. She said, as soon as the picture was being snapped on the 1, 2, 3, he dropped his hand from my waist down to my buttocks and gave it a nice ripe squeeze, which would account for the fact that in the photograph, my mouth is hanging wide open. She was 16 years old. She was a child at the time. See, she's the sixth woman to allege that they were groped by him, whose original statements about the incident centered on the fact that his hands are near women's bottoms because of the wheelchair that he's used for the past several years. So, I don't know. We'll see. His spokesman, a guy called Jim McGrath, said he simply does not have it in his heart to knowingly cause anyone harm or distress. And he again apologizes to anyone he might have offended during a photo op. What do you make of that? Do you think it's on purpose? When you say he doesn't have it in his heart to knowingly cause harm or distress, do you think he just feels like it's okay to grab women's butts during photo ops and he's not intentionally causing harm or distress? That's just sort of what you do. What do you suppose?
Me? Oh, man.
Yeah.
I don't know. He would have to do it to both sexes then, if that's a real thing, right? So where are all the dudes that are like, oh, president touched my butt? you know, where's the guys at?
Yeah, yeah. I think you're right. I don't know. Do you not put your... Well, no, because in photo ops, you put your arm around guys, right? Do you? I don't know. I'm English and untouchy. Like, I generally like to not be touched and not touch people. Like, I like a handshake, the occasional bro hug. But, you know, I have a bubble and I would prefer if you kept out of it. I kind of don't care who you are. So, like, if someone wants to take a picture with me and they go to put their arm around me, I might put my arm around then. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with standing next to each other and not touching. That's fine with me, too. So, I wouldn't know. I wouldn't know if it's normal for dudes to... Do you...
I don't know.
Your arm around people?
I mean, I don't know. It depends on the scenario. You know, what if you're like hugging a survivor or so, you know, of something?
How many survivors do you find yourself hugging?
Who, me?
Funkhouser.
I mean, I'm not the president.
What have you been moonlighting as? No, these aren't like survivors that Bush was hugging. These are just sort of like people.
Regular,
you know,
people,
like this,
sure.
Is,
I don't know. It's all spin. You know, it's all spin, but it seems to be like it's a witch hunt right now, but in the good way, I think.
I think, yeah, no, look, it's absolutely become a witch hunt, but there's been a 180 degree change in attitudes towards what's acceptable toward women, you know, specifically women, and then, you know, men as well, but there's been 180 degree change and shift in what is acceptable behavior, and people that have been participating in unacceptable behavior have made that very clear to them over the last, if there was a question mark around it, hey, that's not cool. So, I mean, that's a good thing. It's a horrible way for it to come about, but it's also cool that all of a sudden there's two things that are changing. One, guys feel like it's maybe not okay to touch people in a way that is not invited. And two, people that have been touched inappropriately, or people that have been harassed or whatever the case may be inappropriately, now feel, I think, a little bit more emboldened and empowered to talk about it. And the fact that these things were kept hush hush and quiet for so long, I think that's a really valuable change, that people now feel like it's okay to say, hey, that's not cool. And this person did this to me. And no, you know, I think that's,
well,
that's,
it's
good.
A sign of the digital age. You know, it's just one thing after another. The dark underbelly of, you know, us as a civilization is just coming up topic by topic. Let's review what's acceptable and what's not acceptable now that we have all the tools to do it globally in one half of 1 second.
You know, the pictures, the screenshots that this fan of Brand New took of their lead singer, Jesse, naked, like on Skype, there's got to be tabloids gunning for that, paying top dollar. There's got to be people that are trying to get her to fire up whatever old computer those pictures are on. And you know, those, I would be very surprised if they didn't surface. And you know what? Maybe they should. You know, I don't want to see it, but that guy, I don't know. It's a weird thing. I certainly don't feel like he needs to be saved any pain or embarrassment.
Well, now it's archival for the future, you know?
Yeah.
Now this is a thing. Now there's documents.
I mean, like, the guy should be punished to the fullest extent of the law. Absolutely. Yeah. I don't know. You know, but you, going back to what you're saying about a witch hunt, and maybe there's more to it than I know, but I was looking on Twitter. I was like, what's the latest with Louis C.K.? And I just sort of like searched on Twitter for Louis C.K. and he wasn't trending. I think his apology made it sort of like go away quicker. I think he did a very good job of saying what is sort of the right thing in this situation and deflecting and making, you know, because like the people that deny it, like the Roy Moores of this world, and, you know, Roy Moore has gone. Roy Moore. Oh, gosh, that's another one. Yeah, I think Mitch McConnell has basically said, you're done. No more. No, thank you. And lots of establishment Republicans are saying, no more, you're done. Thank you. Meanwhile, Roy Moore hasn't really had a chance to defend himself in terms of having this contradictory evidence that he's talking about. He hasn't had an opportunity to present it, maybe because it doesn't exist. And he's a giant creep that, you know, went after 14-year-olds when he was in his 30s. I'm not saying, I'm just saying. But it's so sort of like all over the place, but his constant denial has just made the story grow and grow and grow. Louis C.K. came out and said, the stories are true. Sorry, I'm a bad person. I'm going to take a step back. And I was like, wow, he's not trending. But you know who was trending on Twitter, Funkhouser? When I went to check on the Louis C.K. situation.
Who?
Fred Armisen.
Oh, yeah. How messed up is this? You know? Unless well, it's true, you know, maybe it's not.
Well, maybe you know something about it because, like, this to me fell right in the category of a witch hunt. Fred Armisen, I guess, is a bit of a notorious playboy. He is somebody who is, you wouldn't want your sister dating him. Like, he was a miserable person to be married to, according to his ex-wife. And there's a litany of people on all these different blogs saying, like, nope, he tried to pork me, and then he did pork me, and then he left me for someone who was more famous or more useful to his career. It sounds like he has sort of like a sociopathic tendency when he approaches his relationship with women. But I'm going through the whole thing, and they're like, and all over Twitter, there's, is Fred Armisen next? Is Fred Armisen next? And I was like, going through all this stuff, and maybe you know something I don't, Funkhouser, but it basically seemed like Fred Armisen is not a very nice guy and you wouldn't want to date him. Like, that was the extent of his crime. And it's just like he's getting lumped in there with guys like this dude from Brand New, who had 15-year-old girls send him naked pictures, putting him in possession of child pornography, which deserves, you know, the punishment to the fullest extent of the law, chemical castration and all of the above, to where Fred Armisen, who's been painted with the same brush, is just not a nice dude.
Has, like, social problems, and they lump him into that. Like, okay, so he can't commit.
I think the whole thing was like he uses his celebrity to get girls to have sex with him. I was like, hey, guys use whatever they can to get wherever they can. You know, it's just like you kind of like when you are on the hunt looking for female companionship, whether it be for long term romance and love or whether it be for, oh, gosh, I'm so horribly alone and so horribly.
This is where we need Brandy at this point.
Oh, Brandy Anderson?
Female perspective, yeah, for sure.
You do need, well, just, yeah, but one of the above is very clearly a crime. Being in possession of child pornography that you had a 15-year-old girl send you is a horrible, insidious, awful crime. And being a lousy guy to date that's really mean and treats you horribly is not a crime. It makes you a scumbag, but it doesn't make you a child pornographer. And it's crazy, unless somebody knows something about Fred Armisen that I don't. And I'm totally willing to be corrected. But I was like digging through this stuff. They're like, is Fred Armisen next? Is Fred Armisen next? And I was like, I don't see anything here that falls into the category of a crime. And I don't know, this sexual misconduct thing, like, is a weird term because in some cases I genuinely feel as though it's too light, you know, misconduct. No, you're a child pornographer. It's not misconduct. That's a revolting, heinous crime. You're sick and you need to be locked up and punished for your heinous, revolting crime. Misconduct is such a weird thing because I feel like it's not anywhere near a heavy-handed term enough to describe stuff like that, the Brand New guy. And then on the flip side of it, misconduct is sleeping with a girl and then breaking up with her because a more pretty or useful to your career girl comes along the way Fred Armisen is supposed to have done. Is that misconduct? Like, I did, it's a weird thing. Very odd.
To be continued.
Well, shall we do a bit of news, Funkhouser?
I guess so.
Oh, wait.
What?
Before we do the news, as we finish out the show today, I'm going to play you music from a band out of Seattle. They came out of Seattle in the early to mid-90s. And unlike the vast majority of the rest of the bands in Seattle that came out in the early to mid-90s, they were not a bunch of guys that made a living by setting their depression to music. They were happy and or go lucky. And they actually had one big song, one really, really big song that was essentially telling the rest of the bands from Seattle to cheer the hell up. Which band are we talking about? We'll get into it a little later on. Now, though, Funkhouser, let's do the
news. I can't wait to know.
This is My Witness News, in no way, shape, or form fair and certainly not balanced. And now, super producer to the stars, Barry Funkhouser. Barry Funkhouser.
Oh, that
me,
guy.
Barry Funkhouser.
Are you sure you know now?
I think we're all aware. Go on.
There's a new Star Wars trilogy in the works, just in case you are missing it.
I'm excited. You've never seen Star Wars, and
at some point
that might change, but you don't understand. Those of us who are into Star Wars get excited by these little bits of news. The first movie will be called Star Wars. We were just kidding about being The Last Jedi before. This one is really The Last Jedi because ka-ching, thanks for your money, nerds, was a little on the nose, but I'm still really excited about it. I don't care. I'm being pandered to, and it's fine. Go on.
I'll watch all 300 movies on my way to Mars when it becomes livable. Mm. How's that? Okay. Louis C.K. says allegations of sexual misconduct are true.
Anything you'd care to add, Kevin Spacey? It's an interesting one. George Takei vehemently denies. Do you catch that one?
Yeah. Shocked and bewildered.
Shocked? Is that what he said?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yeah. That was... Yeah, that's unfortunate. I mean... This guy came forward. He accused George Takei of trying to take advantage of him when he was passed out back in 1981. George is denying it, saying he was shocked. He doesn't remember this person or something like that. And anyone who knows me knows that, you know, he believes in all things consensual. But there is audio from when he was on Howard Stern last month saying that he might have groped men as a way of persuading them if they were, quote, kind of skittish or maybe afraid to have sex. So that sounds a lot like what the guy was accusing him of. Sort of unwelcome groping and trying to get his pants off. More on all of this later.
Oh my.
Sometimes you just know you're done. You're longing for that shining sun. You walk these streets most every day. You're waiting to get washed away.
Now, more AD on the radio.
Back once again, the ill behavior. Delivering and giving my musical savior. Back once again, the boy AD again. Nobody rock a body better than me. Back once again, the ill behavior.
All right, Funkhouser, a little later on in the show, we'll talk about a band from Seattle that, unlike all the other bands that came out of Seattle in the mid-90s, did not make a living by setting their depression to music. And in fact, their one big hit was basically them telling their fellow musicians from Seattle that they needed to cheer the hell up. Who are we talking about? Hmm. Which song? We will do that later. Right now, though, let's continue with the news.
Daddy's Home 2 made $30 million over the weekend.
Is that good? I feel like that's a low number, but I think it was still number one. Like, Daddy's Home 2 is number one.
I think this is notoriously the weekend that just is lame for the movie business, because Thanksgiving is the big money maker, right? So it's like the couple weeks before our...
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. It made $30 million. That seems low. I thought Thor was still... I don't know. I thought Thor was still number one, though. It was an interesting test of the marketplace, though, with Mel Gibson. Because when he turned out that he was the dad, or one of the grandfathers on Daddy's Home 2, like as him and John Lithgow... And when he comes on screen, there was a noticeable groan in the movie theater, being like, this guy too soon. But I think he managed to make it work by leaning into it, because best I could tell from the preview, his character is sort of like a misogynistic, vaguely racist, wildly inappropriate scumbag. And so I guess people didn't have a hard time buying Mel Gibson as that. But yeah, $30 million over the weekend, did really well at the box office, I guess, if that's really well. I don't know. But yeah, his that's Mel Gibson's best performance since he said to people, "Happy Hanukkah," and sounded like he meant it. Go on.
Oh, man. Stranger Things has been voted the most popular TV show.
Mm-hmm. Of 1987. Have you finished the second series yet?
No. No.
No.
No, I'm halfway through it. I haven't had time, but, you know, it hasn't really been calling my name.
I'm going to rewatch the first one because I honestly can't remember what happened. Like, you binge these things and they become your total life for like 8 days or however long it takes you to get through 12 episodes, 10 episodes, or whatever the hell it is. And then the next series comes out a year and a half later and you just don't remember any of it. Like, I gotta go back and watch again. That's the most popular TV show in America, huh? That's crazy. Go on.
Kim Kardashian held a baby shower over the weekend.
Hmm. I wonder if Kanye was happy with his gifts.
Nah. Kanye 2020, I'm still hoping.
You never know. Why the hell not? 2020. Go on.
Taylor Swift's new album is out.
Yeah. Yep. Teenage girls all over the world are shrieking like Roy Moore is approaching them at the mall. Have you heard it? Have you
No.
heard any of it? Like, I saw her on Saturday Night Live. Yeah. I just, it's one of those things where I don't.
I heard five seconds of it and went, oh, okay. Fine. This again?
At least she's gotten over that thing where she's, you know.
She's gotten over nothing.
Well, no, because there was that moment, like, for the longest time, she rode that one a little too long where it was like, I'm just a good old girl from Nowheresville that, you know, was watching as the high school football player walks off with the pretty girl, and I'm just a nobody sitting on the bleachers. And it's just like, at the time, she was banging Kennedys in Amagansett. I was just like, let's pull this one over the side of the reality turnpike, shall we? And then she got all sort of like... pop starry, and it made significantly more sense than her trying to front like she was a small town individual anymore. Go on.
And also her album leaked online a day early.
Yeah. Poor Taylor. She can't even stay in a committed relationship with a release date. Go on.
Vanessa Hudgens' little sister Stella Hudgens turns 22 today.
Mm-hmm. And if you're doing the math, that's officially 8 years too old for the lead singer Brand New and Roy Moore.
Oh.
Who would have thought they would have had so much in common?
No tour going on there.
Did you see the one thing that I liked about that? One thing that I really appreciated about that situation with Brand New. And Brand New, by the way, you might never have heard of them. You might never have heard a note of their music. But their new album... Science Fiction, it was her first album in 8 years, debuted at number one on the Billboard chart. Like, they're kind of a big deal, which made it that much more admirable and the right thing to do that the band Martha, who were booked to open for Brand New during their European tour, announced they would bail after the Lacey accusations. And Kevin Devine, who's the touring guitar player for Brand New, said he was bailing on the tour as well. So it's cool to see people vote with their wallet, because it looks like so much of what's going on, specifically in the world of not just the entertainment business, specifically entertainment business, because what we're hearing, this is what we're hearing about a lot, but, you know, business in general, there's people that are prioritizing their career and their ability to make money over doing what feels right. Harvey Weinstein basically offered a Sophie's choice when he was like, hey, you're going to watch me do disgusting things to my disgusting self while I'm naked. And if you do this, you're going to get the part and a world of riches and success will open up to you. And if you don't do this, I'm going to destroy your career. You're not going to get this part or any other part ever. And it seems as though the people that were tacit or complicit in this felt as though they couldn't have a career if they did the right thing, that their career would be ruined too, that there was financial and professional ruin waiting around the corner for them if they did the right thing. And with guys like this band Martha being like, hey, they might have had a number one album, but we're not going to go on tour with them. This guy's a creeper, and that's not a thing that we will allow ourselves to do or be party to. No. By standing up and doing the right thing. Funkhouser, had you heard of a band called Martha before this week? Yeah, so they're actually making a name for themselves by doing the right thing, which is in stark contrast to people worrying for the longest time that doing the right thing was career suicide. So this is actually, well, it's a disgusting way for it to happen, but it's a good thing.
Leave the stimulation to the professionals.
Everyone is so smart.
KPRC, more stimulating talk radio.
There's something happening here, and you should know what it is.
The dumbing up of America. Now, more AD on the radio.
So a little later on, we will play you music from a band out of Seattle who came out in the early 90s. And unlike the rest of the bands that came out in Seattle and that came out of Seattle in the early 90s, they did not turn their depression into big, big dollars by setting it to music. They did not fall into that grunge category. And the one big song that they had, which is a brilliant slab of post-punk awesomeness, is essentially a message to their fellow Seattle band saying, cheer the hell up. You are upsetting the entire world by moping around the way you are. Which band are we talking about? Which song? We'll do that a little later on in the show. Right now, the Funkhouser, let's continue with what remains of the news.
The average man spends 112 days on the toilet in his lifetime.
Don't knock it. Those are probably the 112 most peaceful days of our entire existences. I wonder how long the average woman spends on the toilet. It was explained to me once by a gastroenterologist that women tend to have a lot more sort of like stomach problems, sort of like digestive situations. And you know why, Funkhouser?
Why?
Because women are smaller. And apparently, we as human beings have this interesting design quirk, and that is, doesn't matter how big we are, we all have the same amount of intestine crammed into our body. And basically, you think of a hose having kinks in it. The more you roll it up, well, if you're a smaller female, then that intestinal tract is going to have a lot more kinks in it because it's got a lot more sort of twists and turns to go through before your food and your waste leave your digestive system. Fascinating, right?
Wow. A gastroenterologist.
Yeah. Yeah, told me that.
I hear the words women... gastro and enter in that. Very descriptive job title.
So, you know the new term for, like, the fancy bars? Gastropub? Like, if you serve some, like, tater tots smothered in... That's the new thing in food. Yeah. Like, hipster food, we're going to have some white trash sort of, like, crap covered in something really expensive. It's always, like, tater tots covered in foie gras and prosciutto or something like that.
Can I offer you what the chef found on Pinterest?
Very good, very good. It's kimchi hot dogs, ballpark cranks covered in something really exotic, or tater tots smothered in something expensive, and all of the above. But like, you get that sort of like pretentious fare at places called gastro pubs. And like, gastro just sounds like a medical situation to me. They're like, oh, there's a really good gastro pub in this neighborhood. I'm like, no thanks, I'll pass. That sounds like not good times. That sounds like I'm going to be spending 113 days on the toilet during my existence. Thank you, but I'll take the big passaroo on that one. Does gastro pub make you want to go eat something? I mean, it starts with the word gas. Also has ass in it. You know what I mean? Like gastro pub. If that gets you salivating, that's where you and I are different. Funkhauser's quiet.
He just
made plans to go eat at a gastro pub with a friend of his.
What's this really thing called? A gastro pub? Well, give me a cheeseburger.
I could really go for some of their kimchi hot dogs.
I just came back from San Francisco, and the big hot item there were Brussels sprouts. Everywhere you went, there was a different type of Brussels sprout. Can we offer you the Brussels sprouts with bacon and mushroom vinaigrette? Can we offer you the Brussels sprouts with truffle oil and olives? No.
So it's interesting because, like the vast majority of us that had Brussels sprouts forced upon us as children, I've always hated the Brussels sprout. And if you offer me like a sprout, I will still hate them. It's sort of like the whole thing. Have you ever noticed when you cook Brussels sprouts, because I've never cooked them, but when somebody else cooks Brussels sprouts, Funkhauser, it smells more like a fart than any other vegetable.
Yeah.
Have you noticed this? They're not good. And they taste a little different to what they smell like cooking, but not much. So I've always despised Brussels sprouts, but I did have like some pasta a little while ago where someone was like, oh, you got to get it. It comes with Brussels sprouts. So I'm like, hipster, no. You're the same person pushing kale on me this time last year. I'm not interested in your weird Brussels sprout dish. But he's like, no, it's not like actual Brussels sprouts. It's just like little slivers of them kind of mixed in, and it adds a nice sort of like bitter aftertaste. And I was like, all right, fine. And you know what? Cut my legs and call me shorty if it wasn't delicious. I was like, I actually enjoyed Brussels sprouts and something. So there you go.
Wow. Times they are a changing, as they say.
I honestly, like, in the entire bowl of pasta that I consumed, there was probably one Brussels sprout cut up really, really small. So I still don't think I've changed my stance on that. It's almost like if you mix it with enough butter and cheese, it tastes okay. As do most things. Yeah. What else?
President Trump called Kim Jong-un short and fat in a tweet in response to being called old. Oh, yeah.
Dude, I mean,
I know you are, but what am I?
It's a tired riff. It is a tired riff. What did Donald Trump tweet this week? Oh my gosh, I can't believe this is the president of the United States of America. Oh my gosh, I can't believe that, this is the leader of the free world. This man is elected. Hold on. What did he say? Do you have the exact quote, Funkhauser?
Not on me. Let me see if I can pull
it. I've got it. It's still here. He didn't take it down. Why would Kim Jong-un insult me by calling me old when I would never call him short and fat? Oh, well, I try so hard to be his friend, and maybe someday that will happen! Exclamation point. Like, what? I'll take unpresidential for 1,000, Alex. Is it all part of Donald Trump's plan to get a spot on Drop the Mic? Like, I don't. It's one step short of your mama
friends,
jokes.
You know, I tried to be his friend. He's calling me names.
Name caller. Okay. All right. Go on.
When he arrived in China, President Trump was greeted at the Beijing airport by Chinese kids waving American flags.
Or as the folks over at Apple put it, hey, where all the kids go from the iPhone plan? What the hell?
Break time isn't now.
Yeah.
Get back to work.
We don't pay you 15 cents an hour to wave flags at President Trump.
15 cents? Whoa.
I don't know. I don't know what it is.
Alabama Senate candidate Roy Moore calls a story that he had a sexual encounter with an underage girl. He calls it fake news.
Yeah. It's amazing. It really is. So, okay, here's the thing. If we are being completely crystal clear about this Roy Moore situation, These are allegations that have come up 1 month before an election. And why wait till 1 month before an election? Well, because you want to torpedo his election chances. And you know what? If he really did these things to a 14-year-old girl, then waiting until the biggest moment of his political career to take him down, then I would probably do the same thing, too. If I wanted to cause maximum damage to a guy that had done something horrible like this to me when I was a 14-year-old girl, people are like, oh, don't you find it coincidental that, you know, this happens 1 month before election? No, no. If somebody hurt me that way, I'd want to hurt them back as much as possible. That is 100% understandable. So I don't question these allegations coming out when they do. They're like, the timing seems a little coincidental, doesn't it? No, the timing seems absolutely on purpose, and I understand why. But I mean, look, the guy is clearly political poison. The way the press has gotten a hold of it, this is a done deal. Although maybe not, because people really support him in his home state of Alabama. He's sort of a folk hero there, and this is sort of like viewed as a scandalous attempt to take down our folk hero. But what's kind of interesting about the situation is how quickly he has been condemned by people in his own party. It just shows how divided the Republican Party is. There's so many people like, maybe also Funkhouser, the people that are involved with him politically might have access to evidence that we as the general public might not, which goes against every sort of tenet of what our government's supposed to be all about. But like Mitch McConnell said, I want him to step down. I've seen enough. Something to that effect. And maybe he's seen some things that we haven't. But right now, the sort of, you know, innocent until proven guilty thing has not really applied to Roy Moore. Looking back at this situation, my gut tells me that he is a ginormous creeper. It's a Cosby-esque situation where there's enough smoke that there's got to be a certain amount of fire, and the fire should preclude him from being part of our government. That's what I think. But as far as hard evidence goes, it's incredible how quickly he has been just X'd out of existence by his own party before anything really sort of, there hasn't been a smoking gun in this situation yet, has there? And this developed so quickly, Funkhouser, I'm not sure, but have you seen anything?
I don't know, but we better get to
say
the song because we have zero time.
Oh, okay. All right. Well,
more on this.
Roy Moore seems to be a sleaze bag. Hasn't been proven to be a sleaze bag. If he is a sleaze bag, he's hopefully done. That is all we have to say about that. All right. So there was this band that came out of Seattle in the mid 90s. And unlike all the other bands that came out of Seattle around that time, they were not depressing. They were not depressed. They were both happy and go lucky. But the one song that they wrote that really resonated with the world was a song that they wrote as a message to their fellow Seattle musicians saying, hey, our music is huge. Seattle music is huge at the moment. And by being so depressed all the time, you're actually bumming the whole world out. Yes, we're looking at you. And so they wrote a song all about the constant complaining they experienced from their fellow Seattle musicians. And that song was called Flagpole Sitta by Harvey Danger.